Amazing stories of someone who had morals, spoke gently, lifting compassion banners, never vacillated to say what's right. His conviction in Islam was eternally bright, was eternally bright.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. My dear and respected brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. And welcome to the first episode of this brand new show, inshallah ta'ala, which has as a title The Amazing Stories. The Amazing Stories. And that is taken from a verse from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. That verily, us, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we tell you about the best of the stories. We tell you about the best of the stories. And in the Arabic language, the word qasas is the actual plural of qissa. Qissa meaning an actual story. And if we refer back to the actual root of the word, qissa comes from, if we look into the actual meaning of it, it's the actual meaning of tatabbu' al-athar, as they say in Arabic, meaning following the steps, following the footsteps, following back the steps of a person. And that, the reason why they called it qissa, as the scholars have mentioned, is because when we narrate a story, when we read a story, when we try to benefit from a story, what we are trying to do in reality is to go back through the steps, through the different parts and sections of this story until the story is actually completed and that we can take the actual benefit directly from the story. And my dear brothers and sisters, in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Quran, if we open the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we try to read through the different ayat and suwar, we will notice that there are just so many stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to us. The story of Adam alayhi salam, the story of Moses alayhi salatu wasalam, the story of Isa alayhi salam, and so on, and so on. To the point and to the extent that some scholars actually mentioned that about one third of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about one third of the Quran, is only stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about. Talk not about the stories that came in the ahadith and the narrations of our beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So if that is the case, it means the stories have a lot of importance in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is one of the reasons behind our selection and our choice on this topic for this show, inshallah ta'ala, that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist us and to put barakah in it, inshallah ta'ala, to be able to be guided to the truth. Meaning that the stories actually have a lot of importance, a lot of benefits. For example, a story is a way for guidance. When we take a story from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a way of guidance to us. How? Because when we read a story of a believer, for example, that lived before us and that went already through this path of iman, the path to the akhirah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will notice and we will understand and we will be actually more convinced that this religion, Islam, is an actual practical religion. That it is a religion, it is a message that was already practiced by people that came before us. We are not the first people to experience it. They went through the same things that we are going through nowadays. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing and is talking to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in the Quran, in this verse, telling him that this is why and this is how we narrate to you and we tell you from the stories of the messengers that came before you. Why? لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. So that we can keep your heart straight on the right path. Why? Because the Prophet والسلام, as we all know, all through his life, he was going through such difficulties and through such opposition from peoples who were enemies of his message. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was revealing to him all these stories to tell him that you are not the first person to experience this. And that in the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a way for you, will give you assistance and victory. And this is why, my dear brothers and sisters, in reality, this life, we can compare it to the actual concept of a template. The same stories, the same laws, repeat again and again and again. It is only that it happens to different people and to different nations and in different ages with different details. But the actual idea itself of this life is the same. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has one thing that the scholars call as sunan, meaning the laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established in this universe, that whenever something is going to happen, it's going to happen in a similar way to other situations that actually happened and occurred before this situation. So this is the first benefit of the stories, my dear brothers and sisters. The second benefit of a story is that it is such a beautiful and such an easy and a nice and attractive way to learn about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us the stories, because our nafs, our person, and our intellect as human beings, we like to hear about stories. We like to hear about things that happened to people before us. Think about the kids, for example, when they go to sleep, any kid as human beings in their initial status and in their initial basically life after their birth, when they go to sleep, they like to be entertained by a story. They ask their mother to tell them about a story. And this does not only apply to kids. It also applies to adults. If we look, for example, one of the most popular things nowadays that people are so crazy about is movies. People like movies so much. And why do they like movies? Because usually there is a story behind a movie. If you tell people, most of the people, if you ask them, would you be interested to listen and to watch a show that has an educational purpose, for example, a dialogue between two people, a documentary, anything like that, or to watch a movie, most of the people will be interested to watch a movie. And that is because of the concept of a story that is behind the movie. And not to go too far, actually, let's stay within the actual Islamic education system and reality and context. When we go to a khutbah, for example, on the day of Jumu'ah, when the khatib is talking, as we all know, after the first probably 15 or 20 minutes, a lot of people, they start losing their presence in a certain way. You will see people that are almost falling asleep, that are not really following what the khatib and what the shaykh is saying. But at the moment the khatib starts talking about a story, he says, I remember this day, I met this person, that you will see that a lot of people will wake up and will become so interested in what the khatib is saying. And if you actually go to the same people that attended the khutbah or the lecture, the Islamic lecture or the Islamic conference after that, when they leave, if you ask them, what did you remember from the conference? Ask them this question, for example, 1 week after or 1 month after. A lot of people will only retain the stories that they heard about. So the story is such an amazing and entertaining way for us to learn about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be more and more and more educated. Now, before going into the actual details of our show, inshallah ta'ala, let's mention a few important things. First of all, the stories of the Quran, as well as the stories that were told to us by our beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, are not fairy tales. They are not stories that were made up to convince us of something. They are true stories that actually happened. It is not an actual issue of imagination. It is not a fruit of an invention that came to us from Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. It is real stories that actually happened in the past that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about in the Quran, or the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam through the different narrations that we will see inshallah ta'ala. As we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى, meaning he never speaks out from his own desires when it comes to religion. He only speaks out of the actual revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made to him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said also in the Qur'an, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا, that the word of your Lord has been completed with صدق and عدل, with truth, and at the same time with justice. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking to us about truth and justice? What is the difference between the two? Briefly, inshallah ta'ala, just to open this topic very quickly, the scholars have mentioned that the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Islam, came to us with two different things. And a speech in general is actually related to two different things. Whether it is ahkam, meaning the rulings, or it is an actual information, a khabar, that a person is given to you. So I can tell a person, for example, or somebody can tell me, stand up or sit down. I cannot tell them you are lying because you told me stand up, because this is an actual ruling. They are asking me to do something. So the rulings can be either just or unjust. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَعَدْلَ, with justice. All the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the Qur'an and of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, are 100% and perfect justice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time, it is sidq. Sidq, when it comes to the actual narration, when you are telling about a story, about something that happened, a khabar usually, a narration, is under the fact of being true or false. We can say that this is truth or this is falsehood. So when a person tells me, for example, currently it is night time or it is the morning, I cannot tell them you are just or you are unjust. I can tell them that this is true or this is false. You are saying the truth or you are lying, whether you are doing it on purpose or it is not. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before we go to the break inshallah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, for example, in the story of Surah of Ashab al-Kahf, the people of the cave, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ, that we tell you about their story with haq, with truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the truth in all the details inshaAllah ta'ala. And at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, tells us in Surah Al-Imran, إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْقَصَصُ الْحَقِّ, in Surah Al-Imran, the story of the family of Imran, إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْقَصَصُ الْحَقِّ, that verily this is the true stories. These are the true stories from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that were narrated to us with the most precise words. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll talk more about this show inshallah ta'ala just after the break. So stay with us and we will be back inshallah ta'ala. Wa jazakumullahu khairan.
His conviction in Islam was eternally bright, was eternally bright.
Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. So is it logical to say all plastic surgeries are lawful in Islam to bring or to regain beauty? It is very misleading questions. Need a very accurate and firm answers. Let us set up the rules and principles to cover all plastic surgeries in Islamic law. How Islam does legalize niqab or veil factor in our modern life? Is it fair to suggest that it is more cultural than it is Islamic? I would rather to answer these questions by just suggesting very shocking fact about niqab. Are you ready for that? How Islam does legalize polygamy when Islam always says that respect natural instinct and natural feelings, and knowing that not a single woman does accept anyone to share her in her kingdom? All what you have said is true. But is there any difference between your natural instinct and your natural desires? Or maybe between your interest or what you wish to have? Or maybe your interest and other interest? Is it true that anything came after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding this deen to be considered as a bid'ah, innovation? It's neither this nor that. It seems very well complicated and confusing to many Muslims, especially when it comes to the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ, and Sayyidina Umar saying, ni'mat al-bid'ah to hadhi. Bid'ah sidab, the very comprehensive definition of bid'ah according to Islamic law.
His conviction in Islam was eternally bright, was eternally bright.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome back to our first episode from the Amazing Stories series. So we were speaking about a few elements that were very important to know as an introduction before going into the actual content, the actual core of our series, inshallah ta'ala. So we said that first of all, it's very important to understand that all the stories in the Quran and in the tradition of our beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam are actually fully precise and totally accurate and totally authentic, that they are not fairy tales. Second, my dear brothers and sisters, it is very important to understand the purpose behind the stories. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us about these stories? It's very important to understand that the stories in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, are not there just for fun, just to entertain us. They are there for a purpose. And the main purpose behind these stories, as we have mentioned before, my dear brothers and sisters, is to be able to extract the lessons, to be able to reflect upon them, and to compare between what happened before us and what is happening to us nowadays, when it comes to the actual nation of the Muslims in general, or to us as individuals, or to a specific group of Muslims that live in a specific context. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ, that verily in their stories there are عِبْرَةٌ, meaning a lesson, so many things to reflect upon. But for who? لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ, for those who are those who have the true intellect, that use the intellect that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to them to reflect, not those that live in a situation of complete blindness, that they forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They only worry about this life of this world. They do not care about the akhirah, about the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about the believers, that they actually reflect upon these stories. They do not only know what happened, they know why it happened, and what is the benefit, and what is the lesson that they can learn from that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says also in the other verse, فَقْصُصِ الْقَصَصَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, tell them about the stories, maybe they will reflect. They will reflect. So it is very important to us, it is part of reflecting about the Quran, that we reflect upon the stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrated to us. And this is why, as you will notice inshallah ta'ala, in our series we will take just so much time in talking about the actual lessons from the stories. We want really mind and care that much about the duration, about how much we will take to finish one story, as much as we will care about how many gems, how many lessons that we will be able to extract from every single story, inshallah ta'ala. And this is why, for the very same reason, we will notice also that the third thing to mention, the third thing that I wanted to speak about, inshallah ta'ala, before going into the actual stories next time, inshallah ta'ala, is the fact that if we look at the stories in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as well as the sunnah and the tradition of our beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, we will always notice that the stories do not give that much importance to the details. They give more importance to giving to us the main information, the main blocks, the main parts of the story, the main sections, the main events. For example, we will rarely find a story in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is telling us that such and such events happened in such and such year, or in such and such country, or in this village, or the person involved, the main person involved in the story, that their name was, for example, X or Y or Z. Why? Because this is not important. This is not important. This is not the main important thing behind the stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to us about. Because first of all, mentioning too many details from the stories or in a story makes it become a little bit boring and a little bit annoying to read about. This is why if you actually read, if you open some books of Islamic history, some of them, of course not all of them, there's a lot of benefit in them. But at the same time, they mention so many details that are not necessarily authentic that you will be so annoyed that to read about something that you can read about in 5 minutes, it will take you so much more and so much longer to be able to read from that book. So that's annoying. That's not interesting for the person to learn. And at the same time, this takes too much of our time and too much of our energy that we won't be able to focus on the actual lessons, as we have mentioned before that, which is the actual main purpose of the stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about. And this is why the scholars of Islam, for example, the scholars of Quran, when they speak about explaining the Quran, the rulings of explaining the Quran, they said, for example, that when we talk about the story of the people of the cave, Ashabul Kahf, that I hope inshallah ta'ala we will have the occasion to address inshallah ta'ala. They said it's not that important to discuss an issue, for example, as what was the color of the dog of those kids and etc. Why? Because this is not relevant. This is not relevant to the religious side that we want to benefit from. And the same thing, of course, applies to the stories of the Sunnah. And by the way, I wanted to mention a few things about the actual terminology. When we say Sunnah, it refers to the tradition, the way and the life of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it means may the blessings and the peace of God, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be upon our beloved messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. And it is actually better to say alayhi salatu wasalam than saying the actual translation in English. Why? Because it is part of the invocations of the adhkar. When we say alayhi salatu wasalam, we get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I just wanted to mention this, so that people will be able to understand, for those of you who do not know what sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means, because sometimes some people, they do not know the meaning of this sentence and they think that there is a prophet that his name is sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we say the prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we are referring to our beloved prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam. Same thing to the word hadith. When we say hadith, it means one part of the prophetic tradition. It is relating to a specific narration that came to us from the words of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa as-salam. So we will be taking inshallah ta'ala our stories from the Quran, from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as well as from the prophetic tradition alayhi salatu wa salam, and only the authentic ones, only the authentic narrations. Because it is important to understand also that there are narrations that are authentic, that you might have heard of the word sahih in Arabic, which means authentic, and some other narrations are weak. We call them da'if. And we only have the right to relate to that which is authentic from our sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Of course, there are a few books that are very famous. For example, we have Sahih al-Bukhari. Most of the people, they have heard the name reported by Bukhari. Bukhari is a scholar that has a book of prophetic tradition, of narrations from our beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, that he made specific to the authentic narrations. And the same thing applies to the other book that is known by Sahih as Sahih Muslim, that was written by an Imam, a scholar called Imam Muslim rahimahullahu ta'ala. And sometimes we say agreed upon, muttafaqun alayhi in Arabic, agreed upon. It means it comes from both Imam Bukhari and both Imam Muslim at the same time. And there are other books of sunnah, of prophetic tradition, as for example, Tirmidhi, we have Abu Dawood, we have Ahmad, and so on. So many of them. But those ones, the scholars, the authors, did not want them to be specific to what is authentic. So they have mixed some authentic narrations and some weak narrations, and we will only relate to those narrations that will be authentic, insha'Allah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and God willing. Now, one thing I wanted to mention, insha'Allah ta'ala, before we close, is I wanted to make it specific that in our series, insha'Allah ta'ala, we will rarely talk about the stories of the prophets and the messengers, alayhimu salatu wassalam, peace be upon them. Not that they are not important to us. No, it is the other way around. It is just so important to talk about the prophets and the messengers that we want to leave that to another series, God willing, insha'Allah ta'ala, in which we will talk in so much details about our beloved prophets and messengers, alayhimu salatu wassalam, on all of them. So we will only be focusing on a few stories that do not involve the prophets and the messengers, but that are still very important because they happened to some other pious people that came before us all through the history of humanity. I will close with mentioning, insha'Allah ta'ala, our main references for our series. The main reference is a book. I believe it was translated into English, but I'm not 100% sure. It's called Sahihul Qasas al-Nabawi, the authentic prophetic stories, that was written by a scholar, very known. His name is Shaykh Umar al-Ashqar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him and preserve him. So you can look for that book if you want to have more details, inshallah ta'ala, a more academic reference that you can refer to. But on top of that, we have tried to benefit from other gems and information that were mentioned in other books that the scholars have written before that, the scholars of Islam. And the last thing is a few reflections that I have made about these stories that I have added on those stories. Some of these reflections are just obvious. They do not need much thinking. But some others, I had to refer to a few of our ulama, a few of our scholars, to be able to verify if that is an accurate information before coming here. And I would encourage you at the same time, my dear brothers and sisters, and we will close with this advice, inshallah ta'ala. I would encourage you to go home. Every time you listen to a story, to one of our stories, inshallah ta'ala, try to reflect more, make more reflections, because maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you have some reflections that we never thought about, and you can verify that information after your reflection with one of the students of knowledge or your local imam, etc. Jazakumullahu khairan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for your patience and your attention. And inshallah ta'ala, I promise you in our next episode, we will start with the first story. Stay with us, and inshallah ta'ala, we will meet again in our next episode. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
I love the Prophet who struggled so hard when his mission was just a start. He held the hands of each companion, unashamed to play with little children, with little children. Amazing stories of someone who had morals, spoke gently, lifting compassion banners, never vacillated to say what's right. His conviction in Islam was eternally bright, was eternally bright.